Hello everyone, now we'll have a hands-on on the practical Python session in this video. So let's run certain programming concepts. We have already understood about dictionaries, lists and strings in Python in our previous video sessions. So in this video we'll work with hands-on with all of these things together. Okay, so as you can see over here, we have a number of different operations performed over certain variables and values inside this particular piece of code. Let's run this piece of code first of all and let's have a look what all is happening. Now either you can run this from over here or you can simply press F5 for running it. Fine, so these are the various commands and these are the various results of these commands respectively. So let's have a look what all is happening. In the first four statements, we have imported values to certain variables. So we have four variables, num1, num2, num3 and num4, and we have assigned different values, integer values to these variables. Now over here, we are performing addition over these variables. We have created another variable addition, and then we are adding num1 and num2 and storing the result inside addition variable. And finally, we are printing the sum of these four integers, sum colon followed by addition. Now what this statement is doing, as we know that the print statement does nothing, whatever is written inside single braces, it simply prints that onto the screen. Along with that, we are passing in the variable we want to get printed along with this, which is the addition variable. So what it is doing over here, look at this, it says sum is 12. Now if you can have a look, num1 was 5, num2 is 7, 7 plus 5 becomes 12. So coming to the next operation, we have subtraction. Similarly, we are doing num2 subtracted by num3. So num2 is 7 and num3 is 3, 7 minus 3, which comes out to be 4 over here. As you can see, subtraction is 4. Then we have the division operation, num4 divided by num1. So we have 9 divided by 5. Over here we have 1.8 over here. Now while you divide a number, it automatically type converts your value into the type it deserves, which means that if you're going to divide two integers and if the value is coming out to be floating point value, the result is going to be a floating point value. So it automatically typecasts your results accordingly. Then we have the modulus operator, so num2 percentile num3, we have 7 percentile 3, so we have modulus as 1. So the modulus will not take floating point ratios, it will give you integer values because it returns remainders. Then we have product, num1 multiplied by num2, so we have 5 multiplied by 7, which comes out to be 35 over here. So next we have precedence check over here. Now this statement analyzes that what all operators are treated first and what all are not treated first. So according to mathematical rule, accordingly it is going to multiply first and then it is going to perform the relative addition over here. So we have num1 multiplied by num2, which means 7 multiplied by 5, which comes out to be 35, plus num3 multiplied by num4, which is 9 multiplied by 3, which comes out to be 27. 35 plus 27, so it gives the result as 62 over here. Fine, moving forward. Now over here, if we change the above equation to something else and we put in parenthesis over here, it is going to give precedence to the parenthesis first and then the rest of the equation, which means that it is going to add these numbers and then it is going to multiply all of them together. So num2 plus num3, which comes out to be 7 plus 3, which comes out to be 10, 10 multiplied by num1, which comes out to be 50, multiplied by num4, which comes out to be 9, the answer being 450. So this is all about precedence, changing the pattern of your equation. And then we have mixed types in Python. So what it says is, if you have an integer, say 10, stored in one of the variables num5, and then you have a floating point value, say stored in another variable num6, and if you're going to perform any operation over two different mixed types in Python, it is going to consider the higher type, like in other programming languages. So if one integer and one floating point value is to be performed together, it is going to give the result in terms of the higher precedence data type, which is float. So when we say num5 plus num6, look at this, it gives us 14.0, which is a floating point value. Next we have comparison operators. So over here we are finding out num1 less than num2 is less than num4. So first of all, it is going to compare num1 and num2, and whatever the answer is coming, it is going to compare that recursively with num4 as well and give the answer in true or false accordingly. So we have num1, num2 and num4 over here. So num1 is 5, num2 is 7 and num4 is 9. 5 is less than 7, which comes out to be true. So it will compare 5 with 9 now. So 5 is less than 9 is also true. So the answer comes out to be true over here. Next we have the complex numbers. Now how are complex numbers added? We have a real part and an imaginary part. Real parts are added together and imaginary parts are added together. So we have first complex number as 1 plus 2j, then we have 2 plus 3j, so the answer comes out to be 3 plus 5j. Then we have the power operator, and we have already seen that in our previous video. So this particular operator, which is the double asterisk operator, is used to calculate power. So when we say 4 asterisk asterisk 3, it means 4 raised to the power 3. So it is going to basically calculate the cube of 4, which comes out to be 64. So that's how you perform various operations. Let's get rid of this. Now let's have another set of operations. We have another set of operations available to us over here. Let's run these commands and see what all is happening. So these are the results. Let's map them. Okay, so we have, if you can see, we have written three main statements over here: import math, import random, and import fractions. Now import keyword is used to import a certain package. Now why do we import a package? We basically import a package because we need to use certain functions and certain methods which are already defined inside those packages, and we'll be directly using them inside our code. So the first package is math, the second is random, and the third is fractions. So we are going to use certain functions which are present inside the math package, and then we'll be using the random package and then the fractions package. We'll encounter them as and when you'll see. So the first one is the floor operation, the floor function, which is present inside the math package. So what we are trying to calculate, we are simply printing the floor of this particular floating point number, which is 12.6. Now what does the floor operator does? The floor operator gives the closest number below the value, which means that we are passed in 12.6. It is going to basically return the largest integer, which is less than 12.6, which is nothing but 12. So the largest number, which is less than largest integer, which is less than this floating point number, is 12. Similarly, when we pass minus 12.6 to the floor function, it is going to give us a 13, because the largest value, which is less than largest integer, which is less than this floating point value, is 13. Then we have the truncate fractional part, the truncate function, which is basically called as trunc, which is again present inside the math package. So what we are doing is we are simply printing the truncation of 12.6. Now what does that mean? The trunc function inside the math package, it gets rid of the decimal part of the number. So we have 12.6, it basically prints out just 12 and gets rid of the fraction part, which is 0.6. And similarly, when you do that with the negative of the same number, it is going to get rid of the decimal part and provide us with just minus 12. Now, then we have the function to calculate the square root of the number, which is sqrt, which is present inside the math package again. So what we are printing, math.sqrt. Now the dot operation is used to access a certain function or an operation which is present inside a particular package. So package name dot the function name, and then we pass in the parameter. So whatever parameter we are going to pass inside the sqrt function is going to basically calculate the square root of that number. So square root of 256 comes out to be 16. So that's what it is providing us with. Then we have the random function. Now what the random function does, the random function is present inside the random package which we have imported over here. The random function, what it does is it basically provides us with any random number between 0 and 1. And over here, what we are doing, we are finding out a random number which is present between 0 and 1 using the random function present inside the random package. And what we are printing, we are simply printing out the number it has returned rounded off to 2 decimal places. So what it is giving us 0.33. So it must have got a random number between 0.1 and 0.3, and then when we rounded it off to 2 decimal places, it returned us 0.33. So that is how you use the random function. And then we have the randint function. Now the randint function works similar as the random function. The only difference is that we need to pass in 2 parameters inside this particular function, and we don't need to pass any parameters inside the random function. And the second difference being, it does not return floating point values, it returns only integers. So it returns a random integer between the 2 numbers we specify as parameters, and this function is also present inside the random package. So what we are printing, randint 28. So it is going to return any random integer between 2 and 8. Look at this, it is returning us with a 5. Then we have another function which is present inside the fractions package. It is known as fraction. Now whatever 2 parameters we pass in inside the fraction function, it converts them into a fraction. So when we say we have created a variable frac1, and what we are doing, we are calling the fractions package, inside which we are referring to the fraction function, inside which we are passing in 2 parameters, 5 and 6, which means that we are basically wanting 5 and 6 to be converted into a fractional form. So that's what it has done. So the first fraction, then we are printing first fraction, frac1, it is going to provide us 5 upon 6. Similar goes with the second one, another fraction, 2 by 6. It has simplified the fraction 2 by 6 and converted it to its simplified form, which is 1 by 3. And then what we are doing is, we are basically adding both of these fractions, which were 5 by 6 and 1 by 3. So 5 by 6 and 1 by 3 are added up to provide us 7 by 6. So that's all for these mathematical functions. Let's move to another functions. Let's open another file and let's try to perform certain string operations over here. So let's run this. Okay, so what we are trying to do over here, let's understand that in detail. Now, first of all, we have a simple string over here. As you can see, we have a string S containing a sequence of characters Jones Smith. And then we are referring to indexes. We know that we can refer to strings using indexes. So when we say print S0, it is going to print out the 0th index of the S string, which is nothing but J, as you can see. And then we have print S-1. Now what does this do? The -1 index, we don't have a -1 index. What it is going to do is, we have the 0th index as J, and then when we say -1, it is going to revert back to the last character, which is H. So it says H. So if you were to use -2 instead of -1, it were to give you T instead of H. So basically it keeps reversing back in the same string. Then we have the len function, and we have already discussed that the len function does nothing but it calculates the length of a particular string. So we have 11 characters inside the string. And then we have the substring function. Now when we say 1:5, what it does is, it includes the first element, which is the first index, which is 1, excludes the last index, which is 5, and spans through the first and the last index. Now let's understand that in a bit. We have the first index as O over here, and we have the fifth index as 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 as the space. So it is going to span through O till the space, exclude the space, and present it with whatever is left off. So we are going to left off with ones. So that is why it gives the answer as ones. Now moving forward, we have x i:j:k. Now this format is also used to extract a particular substring from an entire string. Now what this does, it means extract all the items in x from offset I through j minus 1 by k. So what it is going to do, it is going to start off with the first index, end at j minus 1 index. Now j over here refers to 10, so it is going to start off with 1 and end at j minus 1, which is 9, and then by the differences of 3 it is going to present us with those characters which are present 3 places apart. Let's understand what it is doing. So the first index over here is O, so it will simply fetch out O. Now the value, the second element we are giving is 10, so it is going to span till j minus 1, which is 9. So let's see what ninth index is. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 and 9. 9 spans till t. So what it is going to do, it is going to start off from the first index, end at the ninth index, and between them it is going to fetch out all those characters which are present at the difference of 3, which is k. So we have O over here. Now calculate the difference of 3. After difference of 3 we have S over here, then after difference of another 3, 1, 2, 3, we have M over here. So look at the answer, it gives us OSM. Then we have the reverse of a string. Now how to calculate the reverse of the string? We just specify the name of the string followed by a double colon and a minus 1. Now we know that the minus 1 is going to navigate it to the last character of the string, which is h. So it is going to start off from h and go till the starting of the string. So look at this, it presents us with a reverse of the string. Then we have concatenation. So what it does, it basically appends the characters to the string. So we have John's, Smith, X, Y, Z, which we append it. Then we have a function find, which can be used to find the index of a string. So if you are going to pass any substring of the original string and use the find function, it is going to basically find the index associated with that particular substring. So we are passing in mi. Mi is present at the 7th index, so it is presenting us a 7. Then we have the upper function. Now what the upper function does? The upper function we've already seen converts your entire string into uppercase. So we have John Smith in uppercase over here. And then we have formatting. So what can you do if you are to print a particular sentence over here? You can simply use the format specifier percentile s referring to a particular string. So we can write percentile s like percentile s, and then we can specify what these percentile s mean. The first percentile s refers to I, and the second percentile s refers to music, and this in between they are going to get linked with this particular word, which is like. So it basically prints I like music. Then we have the replacement functions. Now you can use the replace function to replace a particular character from another character. So when we say s dot replace s x, what it is going to do, it is going to replace all the occurrences of s in the string with x. So we have John X, X Smith over here. Now, instead of replacing all the occurrences of a particular character, we can also replace only a particular occurrence of a particular character. So how can we do that? Over here, we've written s dot replace s x 1. What does that mean? It simply means that it is going to replace only the first occurrence of s with x. So the first occurrence of s occurred at John's. So it has replaced that s with x, and the second occurrence of s, which is present in Smith, is intact as it is. So that is how we manipulate strings.